After the success of Tenchu 1, it was immediately apparent that a sequel had to be formulated for the Stealth Assassins. It would be near the end of the PlayStation 1's lifecycle that Tenchu 2, Birth of the Stealth Assassins, would release on the PSX. Oddly enough, this game had a late November release for the Japanese, so they didn't experience the game until late in the Y2K year compared to other territories. There are some regional differences between the Japanese version and the English version that varies on more missions in the map editor for Japanese releases and slightly sharper graphics. You can even see the missions completed in the Japanese version and Grandmaster rank on the mission select screen. Maybe, just maybe, those guys didn't get the shortest end of the stick after all. I assume the first arrival of Tenchu 2 in the West was done to capitalize on the Western success that was slowly building in this franchise. Not much is known about peaks under the hood from Acquire in terms of Tenchu 2 prototypes and betas, other than the concept art provided from Tenchu DE and Mobi Games. The idea of this game was just to create simply another bigger and better counterpart to the first entry. The most glaring thing that you will notice is the title itself, which signifies the main setup for the plot. The Birth of the Stealth Assassins is centered on Rikimaru and Ayane's journey as teenagers. This is a legitimate prequel to the first game, which provides a nice bit of context as to why these characters turn out to be such cold and callous killers later on as adults. There's also a third playable character introduced who is called Tatsumaru. At first, he is an ally of the Azuma Ninja and a childhood friend to Rikimaru and Ayame. After an incident that involved falling off a long-ass cliff, he goes rogue due to memory loss. He acts as an antithesis to both characters once concussed, turning from good to bad as a tragic character who accepts his fate once he regains his memory with the main antagonist who saves him at the beginning of the game. She is a woman who goes to war with Gota Castle called Lady Kagami. This entire arc is based around war. It is centered around this warring period between Gota Castle and the Azuma Ninja versus this new formulated group called the Burning Dawn. The plot shifts around Tatsumaru's ultimate betrayal of the Azuma Ninja. The gameplay is standard fare for Tenchu if you played the previous title, with a few new layers of frosting on top. The developers knew that playing through the same mission routes in the first game weren't going to cut it for this sequel. With the potential of three player characters, they've introduced a dynamic change that involved completely different scenarios within levels. They also had different enemies, objectives, and paths for all three characters. Also, they had different boss fights as well. This surely beats out the first game in terms of level design because the game really didn't change in between levels when you picked a different character. Sure, it's damn true that you might repeat key events that cause all three characters to cross over for their respective encounters, but things can be more varied with this approach to the level design. You also get access to more kill animations depending on your actions. You can do death from above takedowns, you can kill someone while crouching, you can do a stealth kill also while you're in front of the enemy if you remain undetected after a quick turnaround. You can also swim underwater for the first time in the series, although this gets rather annoying after a while since sloshing around in water like a big dolphin or marijuana can alert the enemies. You can also use a bamboo reed to breathe on the surface of water in case you don't want to lose any oxygen. You can also hide bodies as well, but I completely forgot the input to this in my playthrough, so clumsy me, right? Did you know that the player character can also have death scenes during boss battles? Some of them range from highly disturbing to the funniest thing you will ever see.
He's dead! Hooray! Hey, hooray!
If you're curious and you want to see how these particular death scenes are formulated, then just die to a particular boss and let the cutscenes take its course, or use YouTube and type it in the search bar like a normal pleb. The game still prides itself on pure stealth, which is a good thing if you're familiar with the first game. It's a couple of new tools of the trade as well to play around with. Players have a large access to defensive or offensive maneuvers that can aid them in their approach. Cloaks that can turn you invisible, blow darts that can kill people in one hit or poison them, and gas that puts enemies to sleep. That's just barely scratching the surface, along with the mission editor that was real from the expansion packs like Shinobi Haikusen from the first game. It's now a fully fledged feature where players can initiate user creation tools to map out their own ninja escapades as they see fit. If you don't feel creative, then do not worry, at least there's a few preset missions that get you started on how these levels are coordinated with their own slew of objectives. Overall, Tenchu 2 is a slight hallmark for the series going forward, and they made their stride with a better style of presentation. However, the first game still feels a bit better from a design aspect. The sequel not only adds in problems from the original, like a bad form of camera control, but they also add in new issues that rears its ugly head. These things were completely non-existent in the first game, such as stealth kill animations not completing once you sneak up behind someone. You don't get that same gory gratification from stabbing a guy in the torso due to this incomprehensible glitch. Another problem is the lack of music for this entry. Look, you might find this as subjective taste because people who need noise and stealth games, it means everything to them. But the idea of no music and just ambient sounds that get repetitious is very, very annoying, and it doesn't really add anything once you hear the same owl in the background making noise ad nauseum. There's a lot of good wedged in with some bad and some noticeable spots. This will go down as one of those sequels where you're going to love it as a Tenchu fan, but not be too crazy about it to the point where it fully overtakes the first entry in every regard. You know how sequels are supposed to be bigger and better than the first counterpart? Well, I feel like Tenchu 2 is bigger and better in some areas, and other areas they are lacking compared to the first game. That's the best way to put it. Tenchu 2 was still a favorable success amongst critics. I don't have a scope on the sales, so I have to assume that it did well to warrant more games. I think this was the foundation when the series really started to peak, knowing full well that Next Generation was right around the corner. Wow, it's crazy to think that Tenchu 2 and Siphon Filter 3 was still going at this time for major PlayStation 1 exclusives when the PlayStation 2 was right before them. This would sadly be Acquire's last Tenchu game for a while until Tenchu 4, as the development of the next entry will be taken over by a completely new studio, K2 LLC. The reason for this change is never really specified or talked about in the media. I will state that K2 is a Capcom subsidiary of all things, so join us next time as we talk about the next entry in this retrospective, Tenchu Wrath of Heaven.